We are ready to begin what is going to be a pretty long journey, talking about equilibrium. We're going to start with this chapter in which we're going to just learn the fundamental concepts of dealing with reactions that are in equilibria, learn how to do calculations. From this chapter, we will move to a chapter where we're looking at acids in water or bases in water and how those equilibriums are established and doing calculations with that. And then we will go into another chapter in which we are going to do a few variety of different types of equilibria systems. So we're starting broad in general, and then we're going to look at specific environments in which equilibria take place. Now there's a little image on the screen there which shows the bloodstream and talks a little bit about how oxygen and carbon dioxide, actually, is what it's been talking about here. Carbon dioxide is coming in and out of the cells into the bloodstream and the equilibria that are part of that. We have a whole lot of equilibria driving the functions in our bodies. We won't talk about biological systems in this chapter, but that is one place where you will see it. Okay, so the concept of a dynamic equilibrium is not completely new to us. Anytime you have a reaction that is reversible, and most reactions are, okay, we can denote it with that double-sided arrow that you see there. Reactants on the left, products on the right. We keep that language, even though since it's reversible, it could be written completely opposite way. So for example, we could have A in equilibrium with products, B. It wouldn't be wrong at all to write it this way. Well, we don't say if this is the reactant and this is the product, if we write it this way, that the B is still the product. We keep the language that what sits on the left is the reactant and what sits on the right is the product. Okay? Now, when you have a reversible reaction like this, you're going to eventually reach a state of chemical equilibrium, where every time the forward reaction takes place, the reverse reaction will take place at the same rate. So we talked about rates of reactions in our previous chapter. At the rate of the forward reaction takes place, at the exact same rate that the reverse reaction is taking place, so they're happening every time one takes place, the other takes place, you have reached the state of dynamic equilibrium. There's still something going on, so that's why we use the word dynamic. The reaction is still occurring, but when you look at it from the outside in and you're examining things, it doesn't look like it's changing at all. So that's the equilibrium part. Now, when I think about a common example, that's an everyday example of an equilibrium, I think about a restaurant at peak hours, okay? People are coming in and leaving at a consistent rate. A table opens up because four people left, four people can come in and take that table. So you've got this dynamic equilibrium established. Now you can easily mess with that equilibrium and cause it to mess up, but that is a good example of. And if you were looking at from way up high down, it looks like, well, the lobby's full all the time, the restaurant's full all the time, doesn't look like anything's happening. But when you get down on the level of the people, you can see people are coming and going and coming and going at a nice equal rate. Okay? Now here is a picture of a dynamic equilibrium taking place with our molecules there. We have, let's see if I've got the substances, there you go. Hydrogen is reacting with chlorine to make HCl. Okay, so we've got our balanced reaction written. And as time goes by, we see some change taking place. On the far left, we haven't made any HCl yet, right? And we start producing some HCl. So I will circle a few of the HCl molecules so that we make sure we can find it. There's an HCl, there's an HCl, there's an HCl. So I've made four of them right there. So in the first 12 minutes, I have converted two of these with two of these and made four of those. Well, time goes by a little bit further and I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of these. So I've gotten a little bit further. And in the next little time, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 of these. Okay, and time keeps going on by and the reaction is still taking place. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. No change is taking place anymore. In those next 12 minutes that have gone by, nothing is, it looks like it's happened, but the reaction is still taking place. So here's the numbers for that, okay? I didn't have to circle them for you, but we see that the H2 and the Cl2 are diminishing. The HCl is being formed, but there becomes some point where you're not observing any measurable change, but that doesn't mean the reaction has stopped taking place. All right, so the dynamic equilibrium part, the rate of the forward reaction, the rate of the reverse reaction are exactly the same. They're equal. The concentrations of the reactants and the products are not going to change. So you see nice straight lines once you've reached that dynamic equilibrium. They're not equal to each other. And it's not true that HCl is twice as big as HNCl. We just know that once equilibrium is established, however much there is in there, it's not going to change as time goes by. Now, I have this picture up here because I want you to know that this is not the first time we've talked about dynamic equilibrium. I want you to pull forward from your mind examples. One example was establishing a vapor pressure. That was called an equilibrium vapor pressure because what happens is every time one molecule evaporates, one's going to condense once you've reached that point. Or over here, when you've got a gas being dissolved in a liquid, you get so much to dissolve in there, and it's not like it stops. Every time one molecule dissolves, of carbon dioxide in this case, one will evaporate. You also could have that with a solid dissolved in the water. Every time one dissolved, and then one of them would undissolve, would come out of, we call that recrystallize. So we have the dissolution, recrystallization occurring if it were a solid in there. So we have talked about this equilibrium state, but we've never done any calculations and really not pushed this concept very far. Now look at these three graphs here. And what's happening here? This is just the equilibrium between N2O4 and NO2. Okay, so what's happening in figure, we'll call it figure one, okay, what's happening here? Well, you're starting with none, this is zero, so none of this, and you're starting with some of this. Well, it's a reversible reaction, so it's going to start off by going this direction only because that's its only choice, right? And you start using up, you see this dropping down, you're using up the NO2. Well, as soon as you produce some of the NO2, it can start reacting, and so we start having it form as well. Let me erase that. I don't know what it's doing there. So we have it's increasing, but there gets to be a point where you don't see any change. Now, what's happening in image number two? In image number two, what are we starting with? Well, in this case, we are starting with some of this and none of that. Well, at first, all we can do is use up some of this. So it starts going in this direction at first. As soon as you produce some of the green, which is the NO2, then it can react. So its concentration is going to be going up. This guy's going to come down until they both are the same. Now, this one we started with, number three, we started with a scenario of we've got some of this and some of that. Now, which one happened first? Well, which one's going up? We're getting more N2O4. So it's starting off by going this way a little bit more than the other direction, but eventually get to the point where the forward reaction, the reverse reaction are happening at exactly the same rate. So no matter how much you start with, whether it's all of the NO2, which is here, okay, all of the NO2, or you start with all of the N2O4, this is what we're starting with here, or you're starting with some of both, eventually equilibrium will be reached. Now look at those three diagrams once equilibrium is reached. Does it look like any of them have something in common? Does it look like you always have twice as much NO2 as you have N2O4? Okay, certainly not. I have more N2O4 in every single case. So when you first look at it, it doesn't look like they have anything much in common except you have established an equilibrium. Okay, looks like there's very, very little mathematical connection between that. But that's what's going to be up next in our next lesson. We're going to see that indeed, while it looks like they do not have any connections, There are connections between those three, and we're going to see what that is in our next lesson.